The Pacific Northwest. Mountains covered in majestic forests. Graceful streams flow from ridgetops to the rugged coast. The waters sustain a vast array of life, from tiny amphibians to powerful bears, plus the communities of man. In these currents lives a species vital to all, the Pacific salmon. For thousands of years, there were multitudes of salmon in numbers now incomprehensible. Salmon sustained the native people, yet still thrived in the virgin world. Then, in the late 1800s, the settlers arrived, beckoned by the wealth of the land and the bounties of the waters. The resources were abundant and nurtured society. As the cities grew, the demands on the land and ocean increased, and slowly, the salmon populations began to decline. Yet their ability to adapt and reproduce allowed them to rebound. But by 1990, their habitat was so damaged and their numbers so few that for the first time, many faced extinction. The commerce and culture of the Northwest would never be the same.
We see a situation now here in this harbor where of the 350 salmon boats that used to provide a family income for fishermen in this community, we now have probably about 25 boats at the most participating in the fishery far away from their home port. It's really a sad story. Now what you see here is the fleet just sitting idle. And this has largely happened because of the decline of salmon populations.
As Indian people, we recognize that our fate will be that of the resources. Our fate's always been that of the resources. When they were in good supply and in good shape, we were in good supply and in good shape. Today, we're not so sure what our future has to hold, just like that of the salmon.
The reasons for the decline are well understood, as are the solutions for their recovery. The people and government must have the political will to take action if the salmon are to be saved.
These watersheds are the key to the survival, not only of fish and wildlife, but they're the key to survival, finally, of us. Because when species can no longer survive on this planet, that has direct impact on our quality of life, and finally, I believe, on the ability of our species to survive.
This really is the last chance for Pacific salmon. The fish have been beaten down for 150 years. They're still suffering from the tide of European settlement. We want to see people rise to the challenge of protecting America's very, very rich fishery heritage. In particular, the great heritage of our trout and salmon in the Pacific Northwest.
The Pacific salmon are an integral part of the history, culture, and economy of California, Oregon, Idaho and Washington, and a key component in the ecosystem. The grandeur of their beauty and power has captivated man since the first tribes.
Salmon stocks are relatives just like all of the other resources that we experience within our surroundings. Specifically, salmon have played a very key feature among the Northwest Coast people. They were a very central element of our community and our society. Their demise has had very vast repercussions within our community. They were extensive within the mythological literature. We know that they were a very important and key feature of who we were and how we understood ourselves. Today, without all of these opportunities intact, where instead we have just a city, we have urbanizing watersheds, we have planned communities, we have everything but indigenous opportunity available to us, we feel a sense of loss and a need for creating a different future, I guess.
And when I was small, big enough to go to the creek by myself, there would be all kinds of salmon, all the salmon you needed. There wasn't any trick at all to get two or three salmon a day, and my mother would smoke it and take care of it. But there was lots of salmon, there was no end to salmon.
In the early 70s, when you could easily come out of this port, out of Eureka here, and go out maybe 10, 12, 14 miles offshore, and you'd find that clear water edge and set your gear. Many is a day where, you know, we'd just be in fish from the morning, from the time we drop our gear until at night when we finally get tired, and we've gutted all the fish we can, and we've got to head back in. But I tell you, it's really thrilling. You're working on a gurdy, hand cranking, and you can look down the line, and you can look down below and see, you know, four or five fish hooked up down below, you know, still pumping on the wire. It's oftentimes I can sit back and reflect on days like that, you know, we're really going to miss. Those days apparently are gone for quite a while here. It's definitely a sad occasion, you know, going from the thousands and thousands of fish that were landed back in the 70s and early 80s to the situation that we've got ourselves in at the present time.
Personal income from commercial fishing has plummeted from $168 million in 1988 to $15 million in 1994. Salmon, steelhead, and cutthroat trout are also among the most prized sport fish. The local economies of the Northwest still rely on tourism related to angling. To sport fishermen, communion with nature is as important as catching fish, when fish can be found. In the 1920s, anglers could fish to their heart's content, for there was an abundance of salmon. Legendary author and sports fisherman Zane Gray describes his steelhead fishing experiences in the Cascades of Washington State.
We could look down on Deer Creek, beautiful green and white stream shining here, dark and gleaming there. It wound through a steep walled canyon. It was worth working for. What struck me at once was the beautiful transparency of the water and the multitude of the boulders, some of them huge. I sat on one huge rock and then another, content, absorbed in the music of the stream and the strange conformations of the smooth boulders, the color and current of the water, and the sense of the overshadowing mighty cedars. Deer Creek was the most beautiful trout water I'd ever seen.
Today, Deer Creek is but a ghost of its glorious past, running shallow and muddy. The steelhead trout so beloved by Zane are all but gone. Deer Creek typifies the state of many of the streams and rivers in the Pacific Northwest, waters the salmon call home. In just the past 20 years, their numbers have gone from millions to mere thousands.
One of the things that we know about these animals relative to historic numbers is we are only dealing with a small percent, maybe 5, 10, or 15% of the numbers that historically came back into many of these river systems.